Conard. And good afternoon, everybody, and we welcome you to Veterans Memorial Ice Rink here in West Hartford. The War Chief Sports Council, along with WHC-TV Channel 5, proud to present West Hartford High School Sports. This afternoon, the annual meeting in boys hockey between the Conard Chieftains and the Warriors of Hall Southington. Good afternoon, Pete Labro, along with Matt Conyers and our fine Channel 5 crew. Should be a good one on Senior Day. Each team with seven kids in their final battle of West Hartford. Each team has qualified for the CIAC State Tournament. The Chieftains in Division II, where they got all the way to the semifinals last year before losing to North Brantford in double overtime, while the Warriors look to make some noise in D3, where they're currently seeded number six with two games to go in the regular season. Both teams here this afternoon featuring some dynamic veteran talent. Zach Polo of Conard among the leaders in the state with 20 goals and 21 assists for 41 points, while Jared Florian averages a goal per game for the Warriors. The senior has lit the lamp 17 times in 17 games. The netminders today, a pair of underclassmen, Shea Henderson, a freshman for Greg Raymer's Chieftains, while Brian Cannon will go with sophomore Harrison Frieda, who's played just three full games but sports a goals against average of 0.65. Pleased to be working this afternoon with Matt Conyers from the Hartford Current. Matt, welcome, and all records aside, all divisions aside, we should have a good one here today.
Yeah, thanks for having me, as always, Pete. You know, when you get these two programs together, regardless, you know, it's a sports cliche. You say, throw out the record. We'll throw out the record today because you look around, this is what high school hockey is about. You have a great crowd, a crowd that started streaming in very early today, excited to see this game. We're going to see a pretty high-octane first period, I believe. I think both teams are going to go for this hard. They don't really have anything to lose in this game. They've already secured their tournament bid, so they can play. They can play a little loose, have a little fun with this game. It means a lot for these two programs, too. These guys have been playing against each other, not just in high school, but a lot of these guys have been playing together for 10, 12 years. They've seen each other on the other sides of the rink, sometimes trained in the same rink. So, and heck, sometimes they even play in the pond, you know? So this is really what we love about high school hockey. You see the old rivalries, you see the old friendships. You're going to get it today. And you got two programs that really want to make an impact at the state level. Hall Southington, a team that we haven't really seen reach their full potential in the last couple of years. Now they have a chance at Division III. You look at Division III, there's a couple teams at the top, but after that, it's wide open for who gets a chance to go to Yale. If they can put up a good result today against Conard, who's arguably one of the best in Division II, that bodes well for the future for them. And then as far as Conard's concerned, they just want to keep the momentum going. I know they recently lost to Fairfield Co-op, but that was a big result for them. They were in the game. Fairfield Ludlow was considered one of the bigger programs, probably the odds-on favorite right now to win D2. They were in that game. They had a chance to take it. So both teams want to carry that momentum, avoid injuries. That's another key in this game, and get some good results, good performances out of their younger players, Pete.
Matt, you're talking about that loss that they had the other night for Conard. Really their first loss in D2 because they play such a tough schedule. Had a chance to talk to Greg Raymer about that. He said, hey, I want to play a lot of D1 teams for a lot of reasons. I want my team to grow, but I want them to be battle tested and tournament tested. That's really a big advantage for them going forward. Meanwhile, for Hall to have to play a team like that, really stepping up in competition today, aren't they?
Exactly. Hall is really going to get a lot out of this, even if they do end up losing by two goals, three goals, whatever the score may be, if it doesn't go their favor. This is going to be something they can look back on, and if they hang with Conor for a little while, that's going to give them a lot of confidence, and that experience really pays dividends in the tournament. You can't go out there and get it under any other way than playing these games in the regular season. As far as Conor, you can argue, certainly you can make the argument, that they've played the toughest D2 schedule of the year. I talked to the coaching staff before this, right at the beginning of the season, and we said that we did that on purpose. That's going to be crucial for us. We did lose some players, some key contributors from last year's team, so we needed to bolster up. We needed to get tougher, and I think they have because of it, and I think they're going to be ready. I would be very surprised not to see them at Yale come the end of March.
And again, that would be 2 years in a row if they could qualify for the semifinals. And one thing about this Chieftains team, they were losers last year to North Brantford in double overtime in the tournament. A week ago today, they played them and beat them by the count of 2-0. It was a game that the coaching staff told me, hey, each kid in this locker room was chomping at the bit to get back at North Brantford. And I think with the win that they had, give them confidence, The loss maybe offset to Fairfield Ward Ludlow, but at least they knew that they could play with them. I think they're ready for the tournament.
Yeah, I think they are ready, and that also goes to the credit of the coaching staff, too. This coaching staff came in, and they've done a really good job with this program, turning things around. If you remember, they're not too far removed from four losses, but four wins for an entire season. Last year, they had that remarkable turnaround season, and they've carried it over this year. I know a lot of people didn't know what to expect. They did lose some defense. Come on strong. They play tough hockey. They play smart hockey. They also play complete hockey because they can roll out three lines, which is so crucial at this level of hockey.
And one of those lines, the top line, of course, and we talked about them. Fongemi is the key performer along with Polo and McCormick, who Greg Raymer says is the consummate team captain. Is it a concern or is it a great thing, the fact that they've scored 50 out of the 66 goals? You have that one line you can count on. Maybe a little easier for the opposition to defend if they can clamp down on them in a playoff.
You know, the truth of it is, Pete, you always need a great first line in high school hockey. We can talk about having depth, but you really are what your first line is a lot of times. So that first line is going to carry them far. Once they get to the final two or three games, that's when their depth will have to step up. And their coaching staff has a lot of faith in some of these younger players because they've put them out there. It's been baptism by fire. They've got them rolling. They've tried to get them underway. They've got a feel for that game, so they think they're going to be ready. And on the other side, you look at Hall Southington. Obviously, you start with their first line as well. Jared Florian is such a sensational player throughout his whole high school career. But one of the things I really like about what this team has done this year is their junior line, that second line, has really stepped up for them this year, and they've gotten good production. Brian Cannon, the coach of this co-op, a tough critic, as you know, not always easy on his players, has a lot of praise for what those juniors have done that year, and that speaks dividends about the effort they've put in and how they've helped step this program up from being a little inconsistent over the years.
He had a funny line when talking about his team. I had a chance to talk to him last week. He said, "Hey, my hockey team is like a box of chocolates. You open it up, you don't know what you're getting. They're going to be either really good, really bad." He said, "They're consistently inconsistent."
That's his favorite line, consistently inconsistent. But that's a lot of high school teams at this level. In high school hockey, such a hard game to play on a nightly basis, that bring your A game every night is so tough. And that's what makes what Conard has done this year in Division II all the more impressive. They've been able to bring the A game in those big games. And you look at where they play. The CCC North, arguably, no, not arguably, I'll go out there and say it, the best conference in this area of the state. You play Glastonbury, you play South Windsor, you play Simsbury, you play Northwest. Simsbury, Northwest, Glastonbury, they've all been ranked in the top 10 this year. Division 1 standing, Simsbury right at the top. Northwest Catholic might be the fourth team in the ratings. These are teams that have helped Conard get better. So when you go to the tournament, when you try to make it down to Yale, they're going to say, "Hey, we've already played Simsbury. Simsbury could be playing in Division I tournament in the semifinals." That's that confidence that you want at this time when you need it in March.
The great words of Matt Conyers. So happy to have him with us today on the broadcast. You can see the teams are on the ice warming up. We're going to step aside. We're going to come back with the presentation of the starting lineups, and then we'll have the opening faceoff and more. This is West Hartford High School Sports, presented in concert, the War Chief Sports Council, along with Channel 5, right here on WHC-TV. We'll come back with more a little bit later on. And welcome back, everybody, to the Veterans Memorial Ice Rink. Pete Lamoureux along with Matt Conyers and our fine crew. Meredith West, Diana Chin, along with Jen Evans. Conard being introduced first. They are technically the visiting team here this afternoon. And you look at the starters here, Matt. Some big kids out there, that's for sure.
You know, I was laughing, Pete, because you said technically a home game for Hull, but you look over at that fan section right now, that is a big fan section. And in fact, a great job by all the fans today coming out and supporting one of the oldest rivalries in high school hockey and in high school athletics in the state. That's a strong first line, though, going back to your question. It can really play both ends of the ice very well. We know what they can do offensively, but just as impressive is how they back check, how they play team defense, and how they're able to shift from defense to offense to defense. A very good team transition-wise, and again, that goes back to the coaching staff. I gotta believe that's something that I preach, because if you watch how they've made transitions this year, they've done a very good job in that area, that component of the game.
Steve Blanfield on the public address for us, announcing the Hall starters as well. And now both teams lining up on their respective blue lines, the crowd rising as we're gonna honor America with the playing of our national anthem. Very nice rendition of the national anthem by a young lady from Southington.
A tremendous job by her, really good job. Gets you pumped up, gets you excited on a day like this. An afternoon game, you really can't beat it, Pete. You know, so much of our business is hyperbole, but today, we're not overhyping this thing. Regardless of what the score ends up, there's a lot of emotion, a lot of meaning in this rivalry, and that's what's great about high school sports. And in high school hockey, still, you look at the game, and it's not quite the same numbers it once had, or maybe the same level of talent that is still playing. But the one thing that makes it great and arguably the best high school sport in our fine state is the passion people bring to this game. People really do care about it, and people care about these two programs. You know, the Hall had to go with their co-op with Southington, but that doesn't mean people still aren't interested. Two passionate fan bases that have endured through the years and represent everything we like about high school hockey and the friendships that you can create on visiting teams. You know, it's funny, the coaching staff, Conard, have a lot of respect for the number one player on Hall, Southington, Jaron Gordon. They've seen him play, they know what he's about, and they really want to see him succeed too. You don't get that always, and that's what hockey brings to the game.
Oh, absolutely, very well said, Matt. Matt McCormick, Jared Florian, among those out there as we get set for the opening faceoff at center ice. And we're underway in the Battle of West Hartford. It's taken by Conard. They shoot it all the way down. And immediately we have an icing against the Chieftains. And they'll bring the faceoff all the way back down into Conard territory. And we see wholesale changes. The seniors were starting, and now the regular lineup back out there.
Yeah, like a classy move by Conard coaching staff. Get the seniors out there. You know, some people think that's a foregone conclusion. No, it's not. A lot of seniors don't get to start their senior night. I'm one of them back about a decade ago, Pete.
Face off to the right of the goaltender as Shea Henderson, the starting netminder for Conard. He's had a terrific campaign. Don't let that 4.1 goals against fool you. That's a product of the fact that they're facing terrific competition.
Yeah, he's been crucial for them this season. When you think about Conard and their success and why they've been a little, they were unpredictable coming in, is because they didn't know what they're going to get out of the goaltending position. They've gotten a lot, Pete.
Two underclassmen in goal. Frieda at one end, Shea Henderson at the other. Puck is loose and it's batted out of there by the goaltender Frieda. Here's Jared Florian with a head of steam down the right wing side, over the Conard line with a shot, and a pad save is made. First save of the game for the goaltender Henderson. Now here's Jordan Fongemi circling in his own zone, part of that big top line that's accounted for 50 out of the 66 goals so far this season for the Chieftains. And if you want to do the math on that, that's well into the 70% range that they score for this Conard team. Hall, good job on the forecheck as they have him bottled in deep. Dustin Kilgore tried to keep it in momentarily. On the delayed offside, it's cleared out of the zone. Fongemi for Conard, over the line. Fongemi holds, doesn't have an angle. He dumps it into the corner and then changes on the fly. Kyler Cubbage on the defense. Turns it over for the Warriors. Puck is loose. Cubbage clears to the line, but not out. Held in by the Chieftains. They put it down into the corner. Jack Alissi, part of the second line for Conard, was in on the forecheck, couldn't hold it in. Couple of minutes gone by, opening period, no score. Glad you've joined us here on Channel 5. The one and only matchup of the season between Conard and Hall Southington. Now to the side of the net. Chieftains set it up to the point, a wrist shot, and that goes wide of the net. On the rebound, the right point drive taken there by Declan Flaherty, and the save is made. Early pressure here for the Chieftains as they hold it in the Hall territory. Coming right out in front and knocked right off the stick of Grayson Lacroix. Bad angle shot right on. Save is made, and they score! Conard kept jamming away, and I don't know if it was Grayson Lacroix or not, but in any event, an early goal for the Chieftains, and they lead it, Matt, 1-0.
Pete, hockey can be a very simple game. You keep working, you're going to find success. It's that blue-collar work ethic you need to show in the zone. Conner was patient, they were relaxed. You see when they first brought the puck down, they did not panic. They moved the puck around, get shots on net, get shots through the traffic, and that's what that happened. They just kept pestering the net, kept active, and it was a goal because of it.
And the two Lacroix, part of that second line, Grayson Lacroix along with Liam. Here's Conard again. Close save is made as Jordan Fongemi cut in on goal. And what an answer by Harrison Frieda, flashing the glove and making the stop.
We've talked about Conard's completeness, their depth, their goaltending. We haven't touched on their speed. Maybe it's one of the underrated areas of their game today, Pete. You see it there working to their advantage, being able to create the quick counter, get a shot on. And number two, he's shaking his head. Jordan's shaking his head after. I think he wants it back, maybe go lower. But he put a good shot on, good save by Frieda.
They do give the goal to Lacroix. Declan Flaherty, who you know very well as the quarterback for Matt Sersosimo's Conard Chieftain football team. He gets the assist, and the second line made it 1-0. The top line for Conard almost made it 2-0, but a terrific save by Frieda. And now it was hit with a high stick, I believe, and the faceoff will end up in Conard territory. The War Chief Sports Council would like to thank its many fine sponsors, including those at the all-state level: Keating Insurance Agency, Macca Plumbing and Heating, Reed and Reed PC, Counselors at Law, ESPN, the Conard and Hall PTO, and Mr. and Mrs. Jonathan Gibson. Thanks to one and all for their fine support of the War Chief Sports Council. Grayson Lacroix dumps it into Hall territory, battle in the near corner, and coming away with it is Miles Arenal. He passed the concussion protocol. He was hurt about a week and a half ago, and he was about a 30% chance of playing here this afternoon. Good to have him in the lineup. Brian Cannon said he's one of the jitterbugs for us, Matt.
Yeah, good to have him in the lineup. He can create a lot of stuff for this team. He does a good job forechecking, good job playing defensive hockey, good job taking the body, but also a good job to the governing body of hockey having that concussion rule in place. A lot of years ago, that didn't even exist. So it's good to see that kind of emphasis on the concussions now, Pete.
And Matt, one thing that the War Chief Sports Council is going to sponsor is they're going to have a symposium, where they're going to bring the head doctor from Quinnipiac University to come down and other specialists to talk about concussions. A very worthwhile night that's coming up in the spring. So be sure to consult the War Chief Sports Council for the exact date and time of that event. Rough ride given to a Chieftain, held in at the point, blocked down in front, and cleared out of the zone by the Chieftains. Here's Florian in center, trying to get it ahead to Jeremy Fortin, but back in the zone. Here are the Chieftains with the puck. Zach Polo, long pass ahead, looking for Fonchamy. Broken up in the neutral zone, but back come the Chieftains, in over the line. Here's a wrist shot, and that goes wide. That was Zach Polo bidding for his 21st goal of the season. Had a 6-point game earlier against Suffield, has 41 points to lead that very potent and very dangerous top line for the Chieftains. In his own zone, Declan Flaherty tries a lead pass ahead. It goes too far, intended for Grayson Lacroix, and that's an icing that'll come back into Conard territory.
We've mentioned some names so far, and I'd be remiss if we didn't mention him early on. One guy that I think has really been a standout member of this team, a great leader, is McCormick. He really impressed me early on. I was fortunate enough to see them play East Catholic. Not only his skill on the ice, his ability to create for his teammates and create for himself, but his leadership, you can clearly see he carries himself with a little bit of swagger, positive swagger, that can only help his team.
Deflected right in front, and a big save is made by Henderson as he robbed Richard Mitchell on the doorstep. Mitchell's a converted forward, started and played most of the year on defense, has been moved up front. He's got a 6'4", 225-pound frame, and head coach Brian Cannon said, hey, he can create space and create opportunities, and he had one about 10 seconds ago. Banked off the boards in center, loose puck there, and it's sent back into Conard territory. Doing the honors was Kalen Booth, who's done a good job as the second-line center for this Hall Southington team, and now it's whistled down on the offside. You'll give us a time update, Matt?
Yeah, we're about 5 minutes now in, and that's kind of where you like to assess the game. What do you see so far, Pete? One thing that's really striking me is Conard's pace of play. They've really kicked it into high gear to start this first period. You were wondering who was going to have the momentum early. It's clearly been Conard, and the question now is, can Hall Southington punch back and continue to play at that pace of play? They play, obviously, Division III, a little tougher to keep up. That's going to be key for them early on.
Good points, Matt. I think it's also incumbent upon the Warriors to take advantage of their opportunities when they have them. That's why an opportunity like Mitchell had about 30 to 40 seconds ago, need to capitalize on those when you have them right on the doorstep. Good job. Florian breaks it out through center ice, but a good job coming back by Matt McCormick to set his man in over the line. Big slap shot. That goes high and wide off the stick of Jordan Fonchamy. Held in at the left point momentarily, and Hall banks it out to center ice. Here's Jack Rivers in center. Rivers in over the Conard line. Rivers stick handle and goes cross ice looking for Florian. Jared puts it in front, just out of the reach of Rivers as they tried to play catch, and now Fonchamy spins in his own zone. Fonchamy lugs it through center. Now spins back in his own zone. They look for that long head manning pass, and they complete it at center ice. Here's McCormick bringing it over the line. The drop pass slipping and falling down as his Conard teammate shot in on net, and a save made by Harrison Frieda. And then Hall clears the ensuing rebound down the ice. Matt, this is two or three times now where we've seen extended pressure by Conard in the Hall zone. They've withstood most of it except for that one goal.
Yeah, Hall Southington has done a good job of making sure that this thing doesn't get out of hand early. On the Conard side of it, I think that what they want is they want a lot more shots on target. You know, they've had a lot of activity, a lot of play in the zone, but they only have 5 shots on target so far.
So Matt, keeping track of the stats for us, off the corner boards on a shot, and that goes just wide. Jack Alissi, as his second line has been dangerous for the Chieftains. Held in at the point. Here's Grayson Lacroix, fanned on a cross-ice pass, and it's cleared out of the zone by Hall. All the way down ice. It was iced that time by Jacob Herz, who's the second line left wing for the Warriors. And they'll bring the faceoff back down deep into Hall Southington territory. Good luck to three of our West Hartford girls sports teams, including the Hall Conard girls hockey team at 12-6-2. They'll play Monday at the co-op team of East Catholic, Glastonbury, and South Windsor. Faceoff is at 3:50. That's the SCC semifinals. The Conard and Hall girls basketball teams both in action today. We'll talk about them more as the afternoon progresses. At the point, wrist shot, save is made, rebound is loose, net is knocked off his moorings, and a possible goal is going to be waved off. Friendly opportunity by the goal that time. I think knocking it off was Harrison Frieda. Don't want to say on purpose, but he saved the goal right there.
Whether or not on purpose, he just kept his team away from a two-goal hole. He's done a good job so far, Pete. I know he's let up the one goal early, but we've got an up-close view of him in action here, and he's really done a good job of keeping his body in front of the puck, keeping his body in front of the play.
It's an interesting triumvirate of goaltenders that Hall has. All three of them are sophomores. All three of them have seen work, and for most of the year it was Adam Faust who was the netminder, but the last week and a half or two, Harrison Frieda has taken over. It's been his job to lose, according to Coach Brian Cannon, and so far so good. Here come the Chieftains again. Possible two-on-one. In over the line. Centering pass. Big save by Frieda. Robbing Fongemi that time. Right out in front. Florian back the other way as Hall looks to counter. Jared Florian down the left wing side. In on goal. Puts it in front. Just out of the reach of Dustin Kilgore as the teams open it up and go end-to-end. Here's Florian again. Back behind the net. Centering pass. A shot right on. They score! Centered in front. The top line for Hall gets the equalizer off some outstanding pressure and forechecking.
What a tremendous job of following the play, continuing to follow the play. You'll hear high school hockey coaches say it a lot. That's what Hall Southington did. They capitalized on a rebound out front. They were able to produce. Keep the puck low. Remember, that's a crucial thing in this game, too. Keep the puck low. You're going to generate more action because of that. And the Hall Southington is right back into it. Hall Southington co-op right back into this game, Pete.
Shea Henderson did a good job stopping the initial shot, but that dangerous combination of Kilgore and Jared Florian getting Hall on the scoreboard and tying the game. And you can hear the Hall kids going crazy in the background. Dumped back into Hall territory. Glidden on the defense. Puts it out in center ice. Chieftains look to counter, but here's Abatello. His pass is stolen. Kalen Booth gets credit for the Hall goal. Florian and Kilgore should get the assists on the tying goal. And for Kalen Booth, his seventh goal of the year. Very interesting, responsible at both ends of the ice. Came into the game, Matt, with a plus 13 on the season to lead the team.
Plus 13, that is hard to come by. That just shows that he's in the right place at the right time, an opportunistic player. That's what you want, and not only at this level, but at this time of the year, Pete, you want a guy that can capitalize on chances.
Moore from the point, his shot, and it's deflected just wide. Conard looks to bank it off the boards to center ice. Kalen Booth shoots it right back in. Kalen, the brother of Drew Booth, who was right next to us in our broadcast location. Good player on Frank Robinson's football team. Drew Booth has a torn labrum, and that's why he's not playing in action here this afternoon. Back behind the net. Alissi, centering pass, goes to Fongemi, backhands it in front. It's loose and cleared nicely by Kilgore off the doorstep. Gets it ahead to Kalen Booth, and he relieves the pressure and shoots it down into Conard territory. Dylan Turner back on the defense. Misses his pass. It goes the length. And that'll be an icing call against the Conard Chieftains. Tied at one. Good early action here, Matt.
You know, one thing that's been interesting, Pete, is Conard obviously has an advantage if they're able to set up their offense. If they're able to get in the zone, kind of as we talked about in that first goal, move the puck around, slow this game around. If this becomes a back-and-forth game, wonder if that allows Hall Southern to get a little bit more comfortable, make some runs at the goaltender. That might keep Hall Southern in this first period.
Shot goes wide. Colby Glidden took that opportunity. He's an interesting story. Glidden, part of the second defensive unit for Brian Cannon's team, actually transferred to the school. Lives just two streets over from the head coach and made for an interesting situation, and he's logged a lot of quality ice time. Here's Florian over the line, winds up with a drive and a big pad save that time by Henderson. He flashed the right pad and denied that lower right corner. Through center ice, Hall does a good job of breaking up the Conard rush, but Conard maintains possession. They put it in deep. Here's Polo. Gets it to McCormick. McCormick fans on his shot. Loose in the slot area, and it's backhanded out. That's job one for the Warriors. When they see that big line out there for the Chieftains, all you want to do is get the puck and shoot it back outside the zone. Here's Kilger being run into the boards by Fongemi. Winding around the boards is Gambardella. He gets it to Booth, and Kalen Booth shoots it all the way down the ice, and that's an icing call. That's one way to counteract Conard. When they had that big line out there, Matt, just ice the puck.
It's an interesting strategy. You know, I want to talk a little bit about Hall Southington's defense today. They've really been improved from the last couple of years. If we're being frank, Hall Southington's defense just hasn't been deep enough, complete enough, or strong enough the last couple of years. They've made a lot of minor improvements this year. They're much deeper, and because of that, they're a better defense, and that's kept them in games and allowed them to be a team at the Division III level that has a chance.
Conard on the attack, back behind the net. Here's Grayson Lacroix, centering pass, and it's bunted just wide. Here's Lacroix again. Stick handling, left wing boards, tries to go to the point. Here's Declan Flaherty, doesn't have an angle, so just puts it back behind the net. Grayson Lacroix again, puts it right in on net, and it's caught and held by the goaltender, Frieda. Talked about Frieda's outstanding goals against average. Also has a save percentage of over 96. And even though he allowed the early goal, he's done a good job to keep Conard off the scoreboard further.
You said Brian Cannon, the coach of the Hall Southern Co-op, said it's his job to lose. He doesn't look like he's losing it so far. Tremendous job. He's allowed the one goal, but really settled down after that. Played good position and made a sensational save about 5 minutes ago, going post to post, just stopping it with his skate. Tremendous save, Pete.
Yeah, it really was, Matt. It was a two-on-one opportunity, and Fongemi couldn't believe it. Had the wide-open net, and sliding over left to right laterally, making that stop, was the sophomore netminder. Here's Kyler Cubbage. Loses control of the puck. On the attack, Matt McCormick. Puts it out in front. It's intercepted, and here comes Florian. Left wing pass. Here's Fortin. Fortin down the left wing side, tries to put it towards the net. It goes wide, and Conard will be on the rebound there. Winding it around is Ramsey Henderson. 3 minutes to go in a fast-moving first period. We're tied at one. Fortin winds it around the boards. All this taking place in Conard territory. At the circle, stick handling is Fongemi, and he gets it out of the zone. Gets away from Fortin, tries to slide it ahead, but Fortin bunts it back into Conard territory. Now in center ice, lead pass ahead, another possible two-on-one. Here's Fongemi, he shoots, pad save, rebound is knocked away as well. Harrison Frieda again with the answer. Another wrist shot and a glove save is made by Frieda, and he holds on, this time stopping Zach Polo, the 20-goal scorer.
Yeah, for a young goalie, he's shown great composure in the big rivalry game. Not getting flustered, staying in position. I apologize if I sound like a broken record, but it's impressive. You watch a lot of high school hockey games, keeping composure is so crucial for goaltenders. This first period, he has 12 saves. For the simple reason, he stayed relaxed.
And you make a good point, Matt, when you say that nothing bothers him, and that's what the coaching staff really likes about him. The race is on in the zone. Aronow trying to chase down the puck, but Conard is able to control and wind it around the boards. Puck loose in the corner. Chieftains backhanded out to center, restolen by Glidden. And Glidden throws it into Conard territory. Banked off the boards by Turner. Slid ahead. Here are the Warriors. turnover in their own zone. Big hit, though, by Glidden as he winds Pat Corcoran into the boards. Knocked back out to center ice. Speaking of Pat Corcoran, very nice young man. Did the camera for our girls' coverage a couple of weeks ago. He's the flex guy for Greg Raymer and company. He can play defense, he can play wing, he can play center. He does it all for this Conner team, and he does it with great versatility. Has 4 goals to boot so far in the opening 19 games of the season. Here are the Chieftains at center. Pass is stolen on the defense. Inside of 90 seconds to play here in the opening period. And the Warriors, as they change on the fly, have iced the puck, resulting in a faceoff back into their territory. We talked about the Hall-Conner girls ice hockey team. Both the Hall and Conner girls basketball teams in action this afternoon. Double L action, the Chieftains at 17-3 hosting East Hartford. That's at 4:30 at the Conner gym. So after the hockey game, take a ride over and see Colleen Duggan's team in action. They're a tremendous team. Could make a lot of noise in the tournament. And congratulations to Jeff Kaplowitz and company, the girls of Hall, the last girls basketball team to qualify at number 32 in Double L. They'll take on perennial power Mercy at a 3:00 start in Middletown. Steve Blanchfield, the PA announcer, telling us 1 minute to go in the period as Hall escapes their zone. Booth passes ahead to Florian, tries a stick handle in, over the line, they're offside as Rivers took the drop pass, but already trapped in the zone was Florian. What a boost this would be, Matt Conyers, if Hall could get out of this period tied 1-1.
Oh, it's going down early against a Division II opponent, clearly the favorite, and I don't think we're saying anything out of line, but they've played themselves back in this game, and a really good job by the defense. They haven't messed around. There's traffic in front. There's loose pucks. They've gotten rid of the puck. It's not always pretty, but sometimes simplicity is the way to do things in high school hockey, isn't it? Clear that puck, move on, cut your losses.
Yeah, absolutely. And been a workmanlike period for the Warriors. They've really had only 2 or 3 good scoring opportunities, but they cashed in on one of them. Kalen Booth with the goal. Grayson Lacroix opened the scoring for Conard. Now here are the Chieftains. Dangerous. Put out in front. Wrist shot from the point. It's fanned on that time. Paul Wilson had an opportunity. Held in at the right point. They try to slide it ahead. Puck loose at the blue line and cleared out by the Warriors. Now long pass ahead. Here's McCormick. Stick handles in over the line. Here's Fongemi. Back to McCormick. McCormick in the right corner. Puts it out in front and it just goes through the crease. Fongemi on the rebound, and you hear the buzzer sounding, ending play in the first period. So, pretty much as we expected, Matt Conyers, dominated by Conard. Great saves by Frieda. He's been the equalizer. The team's trading goals, and it's 1-1 after one.
Yeah, not a bad first period. Pretty fun watching this today, Pete. Kind of what you hope for when you go into a high school hockey game, an afternoon rivalry game. We've gotten that. Very good play from Frieda. He's got 14 saves after the first period. A sensational job. Really been impressive in his ability to move back and forth. Watch the progress of the puck. On the other side, you look at Conner. They've done a really good job of trying to put pressure. Now they want to make sure that pressure is almost heightened to another level. Make sure it's on target. They're getting that at rebounds to bounce back. Maybe look for a little more sustained offense when they're in the offensive zone. If they do that, they're going to find the net. But the question is, can they find a way to break Frieda? He hasn't broken yet, really.
So an outstanding period. Tied at 1. The War Chief Sports Council would like to thank its many fine sponsors, including those at the captain's level, Hartford Distributors, Franklin Fine Beers, Cork and Bottle, the Babe Ruth Organization, and Coastal Tool and Rob Lutkin. Also to the all-conference supporters, Allied Printing and the Hartford Golf Club. Thanks to one and all for your patronage of the War Chief Sports Council, allowing games like this to happen here this afternoon. We're in between periods 1 and 2, the Battle of West Hartford. The score after 1, it is Hall Southington 1, Conard 1. Matt Conyers and I come back with second period action right after this on WHC-TV Channel 5, as presented by the War Chief Sports Council. welcome you back to the Veterans Memorial Ice Rink here in West Hartford. As you can see, the teams are coming back onto the ice surface to play in the second period. Basketball team, Open Arm Christian Ministries, Final Cut Barbershop, Dave Newman Photography, Edward Connors Insurance, Stanley and Elaine Phillips, Beth Barry Brown of the William Ravis Agency, and the West Hartford Girls Lacrosse League. Thanks to one and all for their sponsorship of the War Chief Sports Council. So Matt, what do you look for here in period two?
Well, Pete, the real story of that first period was the play of the young gun goaltender Harry Freedom. The first thing I'm going to look for is shot discrepancy. They had the advantage in shots. Harry's going to have to be big again. And on the other side, I want to see if Conard can have some more sustained pressure moving the puck around in their own offensive zone and shots on frame. If they have shots on frame, shots on target, they're going to have a good chance of adding up the score here.
As Matt told you, unofficially 15-5 in shots on goal for the Conard Chieftains in the opening period. Here's Jared Florian with the puck for the Warriors. A wrist shot off the glove of the netminder that time. A little shaky was Henderson, and it went wide. Now here's McCormick. Banks it off the boards for Fongemi. Fongemi at center. Went down. No penalty call. We didn't have a penalty call in the entire first period, so we didn't get to see the vaunted power plays of either side. Now the puck free in Hall territory, and it's off the boards and out to center ice. Here's Gambardella, one of the captains for Hall, leads it ahead to Florian, has the puck stolen by Fongemi, and Jordan just backhands it back in to Hall territory. Conard changing on the fly. Hall clears it out of the zone. They wave off any icing as Declan Flaherty goes back to play it for the Chieftains. Long pass at center for Grayson Lacroix, and he sticks it into Hall territory. Back behind the net, Pat Corcoran loses control for the Chieftains and is back out to center ice. Now through center, Jack Alissi loses control of the puck. It's free in the neutral zone, and Grayson Lacroix just lifts it back behind the Warriors' net. He didn't get to center ice, I don't believe, and that's an icing call.
That's an icing call. Pete, going to get a face-off down this end, get a nice up-close look at it. For Hall Southington, they gotta capitalize when they get chances down here, because a lot of their opportunities have come on the transition, they've come on the go. They haven't really put a lot of pressure on Henderson inside his own zone, so this is gonna be a crucial period right here for the Hall Southington co-op.
Held in at the point, a wrist shot, and that goes high and wide. Kevin Carr took the shot. Now a rebound was put right out in front, and it's knocked back out to center. Just out of the reach of Mitchell, comes all the way in and on goal. Now some extracurriculars, and the boys start to really get things going in front of the goal crease. Mitchell's a big kid, got a little aggressive going for that rebound. Taking exception was Henderson, and there it goes.
I don't think this rivalry means anything. I think you saw it right there, folks. A lot of passion, a lot of emotion, and your goaltender even getting into your freshman goaltender. He's spicy, he's ready. You got to manage those emotions in a game like this, because you got to remember, you don't want to do anything stupid. You don't want to do anything that hurts you moving forward. It's all good and fun, because this is also a very good springboard for your postseason today, because the both teams have that position locked up. So you got to be smart. But I like seeing that passion. I like seeing that intensity.
Mitchell took the shot. You mentioned him in the first period. Very interesting player. converted from defense to offense. Now they're going to move the faceoff outside the zone because they're going to say that initiating all the extracurriculars were the Warriors, so they're going to give some faceoff relief to the Chieftains and bring it outside the line. Polo slides it ahead, and Hall Southington shoots it right back into the zone. Flaherty watched by the forechecking Florian. Fonjamy dangerously out in front of his own net, still controls the puck and gets the puck ahead. Here's Polo down the right wing side in Hall Southington territory. Tries to center it in front, goes off the stick of the goaltender Frieda, but he's able to control the rebound and hold for a faceoff to his left.
Pete, we've been talking a lot about the CIAC State Tournament, the Division II tournament, which Conard will play in, and the Division III tournament that Hall Southington will. But let's not forget, Conard can also get into the CCC North tournament. Right now, they're sitting right on the cusp of it. They're in, as long as South Windsor doesn't do anything to bump them. South Windsor has more games. Conard finished up a while ago. Conard looking to get into the fourth seed and play Simsbury. Boy, that would be a nice tune-up for them.
7 points, I believe, they have in the conference. And that would be a nice tune-up indeed, getting them ready for that CIAC tournament. Back behind his net, Kalen Booth tries to clear it to the line, held in momentarily by Flaherty, but then is punched back out to center. Spinning in center ice, Jackson Starr had the puck. There's Grayson Lacroix, tries to step around the defense, but here's Florian back the other way. Florian backhands it in front. It's loose in front. They jam away at it. 2-3 opportunities, and finally, Lacroix able to skate it away for Conard. Oh, Hall Southington had their chances right there. All started by Jared Florian and his line mates crashing the net. Now Grayson Lacroix stick handles it out. Through center. Over the line, right wing shot, and that goes high and wide of the net. Alyssi took that opportunity. Warriors try to clear to get it to the line, but not out. Flaherty puts it to the right side for Starr, tries to get it in deep. Now Lacroix from the angle, shot goes wide, and the rebound comes to Florian. Here's Jared, down the right wing side, over the line, and offside on the play. Preceding it was Jack Rivers, a little anxious, as Florian, one too many moves at the blue line, Matt.
One too many moves. He was looking to make the pass. If you go back, if we could push the rewind, which obviously we can't, he wanted to make that pass over. Conard did a good job of eliminating that pass. That just speaks to what type of player Jared has become this year. Really, Brian Cannon, really impressed with what his leader, his scoring machine has done for his co-op team. Become a better player his senior year. More defensive-minded, more team-oriented, and you're seeing it in a game like this, looking to make that pass, whereas maybe in the years past, he would have used the speed to try to push the outside. You really like a player that can add another layer to his game when he has one final go at it.
Said he's really getting to the dirty areas, too, and that's resulting in more scoring opportunities. Good save by Frieda right off the faceoff, and he'll hold. I think when you're playing in a Division III, Division II disparity game like this, I think the goaltender wants to be a little more conservative and hold for every opportunity for the draw.
And that's a great point, Pete. He's not going to risk anything. He's not going to put any dangerous drop pucks out there for his team. So he's probably been stressed by the coaching staff. Hold that puck, get us a faceoff. We're more confident that way.
Off the faceoff, here come the Warriors. Glidden passes in the middle, goes off the stick of Kilgore, and back the other way, leading the charge, McCormick down the right wing side, veers in on goal, his shot is stopped, the rebound goes wide of the net. Upended was McCormick into the boards, the Conard faithful wanted a penalty, none forthcoming. Now back in Chieftain territory, the Warriors are dangerous, the wrist shot blocked, the rebound is pushed just wide of the net. Dustin Kilgore just missed there. 10 minutes to go, second period. Tied at one here at the Veterans Memorial Ice Rink. There's Fonjamy's pass to Polo. Polo in over the Hall line. Polo cuts to the middle, still has the puck, and the shot goes wide by Fonjamy. McCormick on the rebound, back behind the net. McCormick plays catch along with Fonjamy. Here's McCormick circling the net. McCormick still has it, goes to the left point. There's a wrist shot, tipped in front, and it goes wide. On the rebound, all kinds of pressure. Turner moved in, took the shot, it was blocked, and Hall back the other way. Led by Kilgore, and he just shoots it into Conard territory as Hall Southington changes on the fly. Good end-to-end action. Glad you've joined us here for our broadcast on Channel 5, tied at one. Here's Florian, in over the line. Florian down the left wing side, puts it out in front. He was looking for Fortin, but it's intercepted and banked off the boards and down the ice. And this will carry all the way for icing and bring the faceoff back into Conard territory.
Really impressive, the ability of Conard to switch gears, to change pace, to go from defense to offense so quickly, Pete. They do a tremendous job of it. We've seen it a couple times in this period. Paul Southington about 2 minutes ago, 2.5 minutes ago, had a great chance on Henderson. Weren't able to put it in. Right back at the other side, Conard pushed the puck down and had their own chance. That's a sign of a good team, their ability to transition onto offense so quickly. And there's going to be a penalty here, Pete. I'll give it back to you to call that one.
Well, some extracurriculars, and Declan Flaherty, who's the quarterback on the football team, threw over 10 touchdowns this year. But this time, he leveled the hit and sending down Kalen Booth right out in front. And we got our first power play of the afternoon. 9:13 to go in the second period, so time of the penalty at 5:47. And here's an opportunity, Matt, and a big one for Hall to take their first lead of the afternoon.
It's funny, Pete, what did we say at the end of that first period? Hall, Southington need to get in their offensive zone and hold the puck a little bit more. And now they have the great chance for it. They got a power play chance. They've got their unit out there. They're able to set up. This is what they want.
Oh, just over the net with a shot by Jeremy Fortin. Just missed it high. Here's Florian at the point. Plays catch. Florian gets it back. Moves down the slot. A wrist shot, and that goes wide. Kilgore can't hold the rebound, and it's cleared out and down the ice by Polo. Frieda out of his net to tee it up for Florian. Here's the high-flying senior with a pass for Kilgore. Kilgore through center. Gets it ahead to Kalen Booth. Backhands it in, but it's picked off and stolen by Dylan Turner, and he clears it the length of the ice. Hall on the man advantage. As they come out of their own zone. Florian circles in his own zone. Now comes out through center ice. The super senior from Southington carries in over the line. Right wing side, self pass back behind the net, has it in the left wing corner. Jared Florian holds, 17 goal scorer on the year. Passes cross ice. Here's Kilgore with it. He shoots. It's deflected. Save is made. Loose puck in front. Puck is still loose in the slot, and it's held in at the right point. Wrist shot by Carr, and that goes wide of the net. They battle for the rebound, and winning that battle was Turner, and he clears at the length of the ice. Good chances right there for Hall, Matt.
Really good chances. At the start of the power play, Pete, they didn't get a couple shots on net. That frustrated them. That's what. Then they came back. They got the activity they wanted. You see on the other end of the ice, a good save there by Frieda. Covering up that corner post. They wanted to go near post, blocked it away, and they're going to have a faceoff down. But the Hall Southington power play getting a few better looks after initially not setting up quite the way they wanted to.
So the faceoff after the shorthanded opportunity for Conard will stay in Hall Southington territory. To the right of the goaltender Frieda, Jack Alissi to take the draw against Jeremy Fortin. It's 1-4 the Warriors. Kilgore, backhanded pass, and here they come out of their own zone. This is Mitchell in over the line, drops it for Fortin. Cross ice pass, a nice one. Here's Kilgore, he winds and he shoots, and that goes wide. On the rebound, Fortin for Hall. Puts it towards Mitchell, and he just fans on that attempt as he was hauled to the ice, no penalty call. Kilgore pinches in from the left point, puts it into the corner. Kilgore gets it back, he shoots, save is made. Rebound is recovered by Conard, and they clear it the length of the ice. Liam Lacroix, Johnny on the spot that time for the Chieftains to get that rebound away. Here comes Hall Southington, another rush through center. In over the line, they're gonna say offside as the teams are back at full and equal strength. Conard has killed off the disadvantage.
Pete, we got about 7 minutes left here in this second period. Really like the energy both teams are bringing here. Hall Southington had to combat that pace of play that we talk about a lot in hockey, and they've really done a good job of moving the puck around. Really like the shift that Dustin Kilgore had given his team. Put a shot just off net, but really in a perfect position for deflection. Good working, good passing at the top of the blue line. Good work. Hall Southington co-op made some improvements, and it's really benefited them in the second period.
We stay tied as Polo comes in on goal. He shoots, he scores! What a move by Zach Polo as he was cutting down the left wing side, cut out in front, held the puck, got the goaltender Frieda to go down and put it in the top shelf at 8:24 of the second period. And Conard regains the lead on the 21st of the season for Polo.
What a tremendous move, a great patient move. He knew what he was gonna do, but he didn't make it too early, too late. It's all about timing, isn't it, in high school hockey? And he timed that move great. Not much Frieda could have done in that position. A lot of goalies are gonna fall for that one. Just a tremendous move, heads up play, timed it perfectly, and his team's got the lead back.
Shannon, you got lucky from the Hall of Southington faithful, but Conard, they have the lead. And a centering pass right on in front, deflected away. Off the right point is Turner. His shot is blocked. Race for the puck. Down the left wing side, here's Fortin. Comes in over the line, and he's offside. I'm thinking of one thing, Matt, off that last rush. Conard almost converted again. This is a dangerous time for Hall Southington. If they want to stay in the game, I think the next 3-4 minutes are critical that they settle things down and don't allow the next goal.
Exactly. And I think sometimes we forget with Conard that they have this ability to really churn it into high gear quickly. They can score in bunches. We've seen that throughout this season. They have no problem letting the offense get rolling.
As a shot goes just wide by Florian. Hey, they put up an 8-spot the other night, Matt, against...
10-spot once.
Yeah, they had a 10-9 game earlier this year against East Catholic. Big hit on the play, and a penalty is going to be called. Kevin Carr took the man out of the play, and Conard will go to the manpower advantage for the first time this afternoon.
And you can suddenly feel this Conard team waking up, realizing, you know what? We got ourselves in a game. We got to get ourselves out of it. We got to start playing like the favorite. They've got the power to overpower Hall Southington if they can. Hall Southington's played tremendous to this point, but you got to keep going back to that speed. It's such a dangerous thing in high school hockey. And when Conard uses it, they can really get things moving, especially that first line. With that speed, their combination of skills, it's hard to stop. And now we're going to get to see what this power play can do. And this is a tremendous power play too, Peter.
Really is. The face-off in Hall Southington territory. The Warriors do a good job alleviating the pressure and clearing it down to the Conard line. Flaherty's pass goes ahead to Polo, slides it into Hall Southington territory. First one in on it is Grayson Lacroix, but he loses an edge. So the penalty on Carr, 2 minutes for a head contact. Fonjamy got 2 minutes for tripping as they set things up, so it's a 5-on-5. Conard actually missed their opportunity to get a power play because while they were setting up with the goalie off for the sixth attacker, apparently, I didn't see it, it was away from the play, a tripping penalty called, so they'll skate 5-on-5.
We both missed that one, we apologize, but really an interesting second period here we have, Pete. Both teams getting their chances, playing a little bit crisper, a little bit cleaner than it did at stretches. Conard probably not quite as happy that they haven't got as many opportunities and had the whole puck in their zone as much. But both teams look to make changes, and so far they've been successful making those changes.
Good opportunity for the Chieftains, and a penalty is upcoming as McCormick led the rush, and he was upended on the play, and Hall will get assessed the penalty, and Conard will take their first power play of the afternoon. I want to correct something I said in the first period. The Hall-Conard girls hockey team will play on Monday in the SCC semifinal action. However, they will be playing at 6 o'clock at New Canaan. Want to correct what we said. They're not playing East Catholic, Glastonbury, South Windsor. They're going to play on the road against New Canaan, 6 o'clock on Monday. Good luck to Brett Soucy and company. Gambardella gets the penalty. 2 minutes for hooking. As Conard sets up on their first power play of the afternoon, looking to increase their 2-1 lead. They play catch on the perimeter. On the left wing side, Grayson Lacroix has it. Stick handles. Pass on the right side. Chieftains regain control. Zach Pola has it, goes back behind the net with the pass. put out in front, and it's cleared away by the Warriors. Slow developing that time, Matt, by the Chieftains, and Hall able to react.
Slow developing, but I do like the patience they showed on that power play. They were looking for that one play. Clearly they have something set up that they've worked on. I like it. Hold the puck as long as you need to get that one good chance if you need to.
Here's Polo through center ice. Head of speed. Over the Hall Southington line. Double teamed, but Hall Southington can't clear. Polo recontrols. Polo to the top of the circle. Polo loses control as it's stick checked away. Regains, puts it back behind the net for McCormick. Sets up in his office there. Left side to Lacroix, his shot, and it's blockered away by the goaltender, Frieda. Cross ice pass goes to the point. With it there is Turner. Long wrist shot off the glove of Frieda. Controlled by the Warriors, and they're able to pick the opening and clear it all the way down. Richard Mitchell doing the honors on the clear for the Warriors. Now in his own zone is Paul Wilson. 20 seconds to go on the manpower advantage. Wilson back behind his own net. Drops it off for Alissi. Alissi stick handles through traffic out of the zone. In center ice. Tries to get it ahead to Wilson. It's loose at the Hall line. Mitchell with a heavy hit there, and it's controlled by the Warriors. They're at five aside. They're down to 3 minutes left in the second period. 2-1, Conard in front. Zach Polo, a tremendous individual effort for the go-ahead goal for the Chieftains. In his own zone is Alissi, can't clear. Held in, rebound in front, it's loose. They try to get it to the side of the net, but Florian tried to bank it off the goaltender that time, but to no avail. Here's Mitchell in front, pounds away, save is made. Puck is still loose, save is made and covered by the freshman goaltender Henderson. There's Richard Mitchell throwing his weight around. He's a tough presence in front of that net.
A tremendous presence, and we talked a lot about Frieda, but how about Henderson saying, hey guys, up in the booth, we're here, I'm here too. The freshman really stepping up, holding his own in front of his net, not getting flustered, not getting scattered there, staying in position, able to cover the puck. Great chance for Hall Southington. You gotta wonder, how many more chances are they gonna get like this? And they have the opportunity to get back in this game against Conard.
Yeah, they have to capitalize on those chances. There could be another one right here. Stick handling maneuver in the slot, but it's skated away. And here's McCormick down the left wing side, over the Warrior line, on the backhand. Centering pass goes all the way through. And here comes Hall Southington the other way. This is Kilgore. Stick handling in over the line. Kilgore cuts to his right, goes to the corner, tries to put it out in front. He had a man, Jacob Herz, in the slot area. To the left point, wrist shot, save is made, rebound just wide of the net. Herz trying to get control of it, get it over to Florian. The Conard defending well in their own territory and able to escape the zone as Ramsey Henderson shoots it all the way down. I thought perhaps Colby Glidden could have played that one. He took the wrong angle to allow the ice in.
You know, it's funny. Two things have stood out to me, Pete, in the last 3 minutes or so. First of all, Dustin Kilgore's had a great second period. Really done a good job of moving his feet, finding his teammates, trying to force the puck low. That's the one thing we just saw. The other thing is I thought Conard, you hear the expression in other sports, take the air out of the ball. We're trying to take the air out of the puck a little bit, slow this game down. Hall Southington says, no. We're going to try and continue to play fast pace, and that's allowed them to get a few more chances here.
There's Grayson Lacroix down the right wing side. He's tackled down, penalty called. It's gonna go against Gambardella. With 1:20 to go in the second period, Conard will get their second consecutive try with the manpower advantage. Grayson Lacroix, the senior, 8-goal scorer, terrific leader. And of course, he and his brother Liam, 2/3 of that second line, and the nephews of the once great Whaler color analysis, Andre Lacroix.
You know, the one great thing about Grayson is how he's really morphed into a heady leader, a good quarterback for this team, can really see a play develop and find that pass, create the open ice for players. That's what I really like about him. He's one of those players that can not only find the open ice for himself, but for his teammates. You wonder now, how many more shots is he going to be able to create on this opportunity for his team?
Here's Polo. Puts it in the corner. He plays catch on the perimeter with McCormick. They have Turner at the high right slot area. Here's McCormick on the left wing side. Here's Fajimi holding with a minute to go in the period. His cross-eyes pass is deflected, but Polo chases it down. Polo at the rim of the circle, stick handles, hands off to McCormick. Back to the point to Turner. Turner holds. Turner doesn't have an angle, so he gives it back to McCormick. McCormick, stick handle, side of the net, hands it off to Polo. Here's Polo. Wrist shot, score! He was able to beat Frieda from a bad angle. Second consecutive goal for Zach Polo, his 22nd of the season. And with 40 seconds to go in the second period, it's the first two-goal lead, a power play goal to make it 3-1, Conard.
And it goes back to being patient, knowing when to take your shot. I mean, most of the time you wouldn't want to take a shot there, but he was confident, Polo, in his shot. There's a reason he scored so many goals the last 2 years. Really beat Frieda with an absolute snipe there. And a good job by McCormick, dropping it off, knowing his teammate wanted it. McCormick had made the run, almost created a little bit of a diversion, and then they pulled it back.
And you talk about the playmaking abilities of McCormick, 25 assists on the season. Here's Polo again, streaking in. He scores! There's the hat trick! There it is, Zach Polo. It's a natural hat trick. 26 seconds to go. That's two goals in 14 seconds. Three on the afternoon, 23 on the season, and it's 4-1.
The ability to shift gears is so remarkable, to put one goal behind you and go and attack again, and it all comes back to speed. It's such a crucial element in the high school hockey game, and Polo's got it. And he's also got an impressive shot. Two fantastic shots in such a short span, a 14-second span there. Goes near post, then far post.
He mixes it up. No doubt about it. And we have a Hall player down and writhing in pain at center ice. I believe that's Jacob Herz on the ice. And they'll have the trainer come out and take a look at him here in the waning moments of this second period. Just seems like 5-10 minutes ago, we're talking about a 1-1 hockey game, and all of a sudden it's 4-1, and it's all off the stick of one player.
You know, we almost saw a goal ahead by Hall Sighton, remember? And all of a sudden, Connor was able to change gears, and that comes back to their depth. They can run three lines at you, right? They can run them fast, and they can transition. They're so impressive in how they go from defense to offense here, Peter. And now with 18 seconds left in this thing, Hall Sutherland's got to worry about it getting out of hand. They got a player down the ice. He looks like he's going to be okay. We don't want to speak to what the injury is without knowing. You never want to do that, obviously. He is moving. That's always a good sign. He looks like he's shaking up. Now we're going to watch, and hopefully he can be able to skate off on his own accord, and he is going to get a large cheer from his fans. But Hall Sutherland's going to have to regroup here fast. They're going to have to find a way to control that transition from defense to offense and not allow Connor to move so quickly through the neutral zone. That's really been a problem in the last 5 minutes.
Really has been, and a big reason why they're up by three. Jacob Herz was the injured player for the Hall Southington Warriors, junior left winger, 4 goals, 3 assists, 7 points on the air, +8 for his plus minus. That means 8 more times at even strength he was on the ice for his team's score as opposed to the opposition. Face off outside the Conard blue line as we wind things down in the middle stanza here at the Veterans Memorial Ice Rink. This is Paul Wilson, banks it ahead, pass intended for Fodgerman, he goes too far. Hall Southington shoots it back into Conard territory. Maybe one last opportunity for Kilger. He had a man, Mitchell, cutting in front, didn't see him, and the buzzer sounds, ending play here in the second period. So, started out promisingly for Hall, got the equalizer in the contest, but 3 consecutive by Zach Polo, and at the end of 2, it's 4-1 in favor of the Conard Chieftains, Matt Conard.
What's the cliche you hear so often at any level of sports is capitalize on your opportunities. Early on in this period, Hall Southington sort of turned the tide, Pete. They were able to get some momentum, but they didn't capitalize on their opportunities in a way that woke up Conard, and it made them play even faster, made them attack, and really, Zach Polo went to work in a 14-second stretch. Amazing what a skilled sharpshooter with a little bit of speed can do for you. That's Polo. Puts the goal in near post and then comes back 14 seconds later, scores far post. Just a tremendous job of utilizing their speed, Connor, and opening this game up, Pete.
And because of it, Matt, they have the 4-1 advantage at the end of 30 minutes in the annual rivalry game here as Conard looks to win against Hall Southington for the ninth time in the last 10 years. The War Chief Sports Council would like to thank its many fine sponsors, including those at the all-state level, Keating Insurance Agency, MACA Plumbing and Heating, Reed and Reed PC Counselors at Law, ESPN, the Conard and Hall PTO, and Mr. and Mrs. Jonathan Gibson. Thanks to one and all for your continued support of the War Chief Sports Council. Matt Conyers and I will come back with third period action. At the end of 2-4-1, Conard in front. You're watching West Hartford High School Sports here on Channel 5 as presented by the War Chief Sports Council. Back with more after this. Both teams back on the ice for third period action. Pete Lammer along with Matt Conyers and our fine Channel 5 crew and all of us associated with the War Chief Sports Council, led by Mr. Paul McConnell and Mr. Dennis Swan. Thanks to those fine gentlemen, and thanks to all the ladies and men at Channel 5 who make things work for us. 4-1, Conard in front as we get set for third period action. While we have a break in the action, we wanted to congratulate the excellent athletic director, Betty Remigino Knapp. She'll be honored by the Connecticut High School Coaches Association at the organization's May banquet. She is the athletic director of the year, and the War Chief Sports Council, quite proud, and she certainly is one in a million. So congratulations to Betty. Well-deserved honor as the athletic director of both schools at West Hartford. Matt, as you know, she does a tremendous job.
Just a tremendous job. Has to handle a handful, to say the least, with both schools, with both communities, and well-beloved.
There was Polo going for his fourth of the afternoon, and some heavy metal behind Harrison Freitas went off the goalpost and stayed out. 4-1, Conard in front. Three unanswered goals, all by Zach Polo. Big drive from the slot, and a kick save is made as Matt McCormick was robbed by Harry Frieda. Puck still in Hall territory. Here's Polo, puts it in front. Tried to get Fongemi on the backhand that time, but Fongemi tripped and fell. Got it to the point. Turner's shot blocked at the defense. Rebound caroms to the corner. Here's McCormick back beyond the net for the Chieftains. McCormick gets it to Fongemi. His shot is blocked. As a nice job by Jared Florian, the back checker that time, to get in the way, and it goes up and out of play for the faceoff.
You know, we left the second period wondering how is Hall Suddington going to stop the bleeding? Could they slow down Conard? And as evident by the first few moments here in this third period, it's going to be a lot of hard work, Pete, because Conard is really clicking on all cylinders right now, doing a good job of getting shot opportunities, keeping the puck down low, winning faceoffs. Conard's playing the game they thought they would be able to play right from the start. They weathered the Hall Suddington storm, and they look like the strong Division II team we thought they were.
Well said, and I think if Hall Suddington's going to have any opportunity in this third period, they have to certainly stem the tide and get the next goal. And now a penalty is going to be called against the Chieftains. And Hall Suddington will get their second manpower advantage opportunity this afternoon.
This is really the game right now. They got to score right now. You know, it's not hyperbole. We're not hyping it up too big. You're down 4-1. Your rival's playing well. It's playing really within themselves right now. You got to get scoring opportunities. I'd like to see a lot of shots down low if I was the Hall Suddington coaching staff. I want to test this goaltender early on the power play.
Off the faceoff. It's won by Conard. They tried to clear. Fortin hold it in momentarily. Slashing penalty against the Chieftains as Hall on the power play. But it's cleared out and down the ice. Doing the honors was Declan Flaherty. Back in his own zone. Kevin Carr gets it ahead. Here's Florian. Florian with a lot of room and ahead of steam over the line. Florian to the backhand. Save is made. Big wide open net, and they couldn't get it home. First, it was Fortin with an opportunity, then Carr pinching in from the point with a gaping net, and they couldn't convert. And then the Chieftains punch it down the ice. Boy, that was a big opportunity missed right there, Matt.
You talk about opportunities. They had the whole net to shoot on. Again, it's coming through traffic, but you got to get that shot on frame there. A little peculiar how he got caught out of net, but Conard survives.
Here's Kilgore over the line. Sidesteps a hit that time. The Conard player is actually down and writhing in pain at the top of the circle. And now McCormick going after Dustin Kilgore. Can't see exactly who the Chieftain is on the ice, but he is lying flat on his back as the training staff comes out to attend. And now the official comes over and separates the teams and forcing Hall Suddington to retreat back in front of their own bench. Reminder, if you're watching this game live, the rebroadcast will be on March 5th at 7 o'clock, and also a week later, March 12th at 7 o'clock. on WHC-TV Channel 5, your home for West Hartford High School sports. So I believe that's a week from today and 2 weeks from today for the rebroadcast.
Pete, as we try and figure out who's on the ice here in this situation, we do want to talk about a little bit about what the Conard program has done for a family, a youth hockey family out of South Windsor, who unfortunately last week ago learned their son had cancer. Goalie Brian and Azazine area, 11-year-old, sixth grader, found out he had cancer, gone in just to find out about an arm. He had an issue with his arm, find out he had a tumor, cancerous tumor on his arm. So the way the hockey community is, it likes to reach out to its brothers. And a really special thing happened last week. Conard, who's not associated with the player in the South Windsor Youth Program, raised a lot of money in their game against Suffield Granby Windsor Locks for the family. There's a GoFundMe campaign right now for the player and the family to help with everything they're going through. But really just, I'd like to say, a tremendous job by the Conard coaching staff, Conard community, to really reach out and help somebody not necessarily affected by them. The players don't know this player, but they really dedicated a lot of time and their effort to help contribute something, and that's pretty special.
That is. To have that rally like that as a community just shows the compassion level, for sure. Fonjamy was the injured player, able to skate off under his own power. There's a late call on an offside play. Florian carried in about 20 feet over the line before they finally whistled it down.
Yeah, and Pete, I just want to reiterate, I apologize, but that's an 11-year-old kid going through something traumatic like that. His family traumatic, a sixth grader, and the community, not just in South Windsor, but West Hartford, reach out. I got to help. Imagine that gives them a boost.
Well said, Matt. 5-on-3 skater advantage for the Hall Southington team. Really a must opportunity to cash in here. Right out in front, Mitchell taking 3 swipes at it, and he wasn't able to get it home. Off the boards, Kilgore a shot, and that goes wide. Mitchell chases down the rebound. 2-man advantage for Hall, and an errant pass comes out of the zone, and Fortin has to chase back inside his own territory. Fans on his pass as he gets it to Kilgore. Through center ice. This is Kilgore over the line. Now it's going to be a 5-on-4. Big slap shot. Stick save is made. Rebound is taken by Conard, and it cleared down the ice. Booth took the shot, and the save was made by Henderson, and the rebound cleared down the ice. Kilgore passes for Fortin. Goes too far. McCormick gets it ahead. 50 seconds to go on the 5-on-4, but it's Conard taking offensive liberties, and now finally Fortin skates it away. Here's Fortin over the line for the Warriors. Wrist shot, save is made. Rebound controlled by the Chieftains, and instead of clearing, they skate it out of the zone. Here's a pass ahead on the left wing side in the zone. Trying to chase it down is Alissi. He battles for it there with Florian, and it's held in by Fonjamy, and now he'll skate back to center, just rag some time off the clock. One thing I think you have to be concerned about if you're Conard going forward, and I'm talking about the state tournament, Matt, at least today, Henderson gives up a lot of rebounds, and that's going to be a big problem come tournament time.
And when you face more opportunistic teams like a South Windsor, a Fairfield Ludlow, some of these top Division II teams, they're going to punish you with those second chance opportunities. Really, the problem for Hall Southington today is they haven't been able to finish off their chances. And Pete, we have another player down here, and it's a big name down here.
Jared Florian is down. Conard player took a run at him. Good sportsmanship here by Grayson Lacroix to bend over and ask how Florian's doing. They're not going to admit to this after the game, but this could be retribution because they went after Fonjamy, one of the top line players, took a run at him, and now all of a sudden there's the best player for Hall Southington on the ice.
As you know, Pete, we'll not get an answer to that one. That is a no comment. Yeah. But being the good hockey hockey historian, you know the game, you know how things work, the inner workings. He's going to be skating off. His teammates will help him. This is not a good sign right now for Hall Southington because I don't think it's a mistake to say this, but as Florian goes, this Hall Southington team goes, your chances of going DeYale without him are slim to none. And that's not a discredit to his teammates who have played really well. That's just a credit to what type of player and what type of impact player. He's one of the top five Division III players in the game.
Yeah, no doubt about it. And Matt, to see him limp off the ice as he did, I mean, obviously doesn't look very good for him. So there's a momentary stoppage in play. Both teams were talking in front of their own benches.
Yeah, go back to Florian. And I said top five in Division III. You could make an argument he's even higher in all the state. I mean, he's a tremendous player, tremendous scoring talent, with a lot of offensive talent that came in as one of these guys that everybody said, you got to take a look at him. He is sensational. He has an offensive mind. And like we said a little bit earlier, he's really developed into that player we all thought he could be, especially his coaching staff, that two-way player, plays dirty, plays aggressive hockey, goes in for the forecheck, can backcheck. And that's what that's why we put such a heavy emphasis on his presence in the lineup. It's not because his players around him aren't good. We're not trying to say that. It's just because he makes everybody better around him. He's a special hockey player, and us in this area have been fortunate to watch him. And on the same end, guys like Polo, another player that we've been very lucky to see score a lot of goals this year. He's really emerged into a great player for Conard. And we'd be remiss if we don't mention him as well, and as well as Jordan, number two for Conard.
Oh, absolutely so. Timeout being taken. Herz got the initial roughing call for 2 minutes for Hall, and then a double minor assessed against Conard. So Hall will come out of this with another power play advantage. Back to Jared Florian. I just want to add one more point, Matt. Before his freshman year and his first game, Brian Cannon, the head coach, said to me, watch this kid. His very first shift against Lyman Hall, he scored a goal. He had two goals in his first game, and you could tell right off the bat how special this kid was going to be.
He was always a scorer, and now the difference is he's a major playmaker.
Fortin's shot is blocked, and Conard clears the ensuing rebound down on net. Frieda stops it for Kevin Carr. Fonjamy in on the forecheck, taking liberty shorthanded. What a job he's doing as an upfront penalty killer. Now to rag some time, throws it back to the defense. Conard on the disadvantage. Headman pass, Fonjamy a drive, and that goes just wide. Rebound caroms all the way back out to center ice, and Grayson Lacroix dumps it back to the defense, and Paul Wilson clears it into Hall Southington territory. Warriors on the manpower advantage, but down three. It's 4-1 Conard as we play here in the third period. Intercepted at the line and cleared down the ice. Possible high sticking call was missed. Stick got up in the face of Fonjamy that time. The officials have to be very careful here that this game doesn't get out of control. They've done a good job for most of the afternoon clamping down on things. Back in his own territory, Kyler Cubbage. Captain, senior defenseman, gets it ahead. 9 minutes to play, third period. Puck deflects off of Cubbage, comes in on the netminder, and teeing it up is Frieda for Cubbage. Right wing pass to Fortin, pass in the middle, and here they come. Kalen Booth over the line, winds up with a drive, and that deflects off the defenseman Wilson to the corner. Comes in front, big slap shot, and that goes wide. Getting it back, Kildor a shot, and that goes way up in the air, hits the netting, and out of play. Tough to wind up with a slap shot there when you got seven people between you and the goal.
Conard's done a really good job. We haven't really talked about it that much, but they've done a good job of getting in traffic, getting in those shooting lanes, and making it difficult for Hall Southington, because you've seen some of these shot opportunities for Hall Southington be very inaccurate, and that's because of the traffic Conard has caused. Now, the key right now for Conard at this point, they've got the lead, they've got the game in hand, is to settle things down to get their composure back at this point.
This is the best penalty kill we've seen this afternoon for Conard. And now they're at five aside as Brent Soucy comes out of the box. Big hit in center ice, and another power play is going to ensue. Hall Southington on the attack, finally hit by Conard, and the power play will be called. About 8 minutes to go here in the third period. So I think that was Declan Flaherty again, thinking he was back on the football field. He leveled somebody at center ice.
It's funny how this game started. We were crediting the play, the even spirit, the lack of penalties, the lack of whistles, and it's really gone a 1080 here in this third period. The game's in hand. This can tend to happen. And now you got to start looking ahead. You got to see what's next. For Conard, it's going to be a little bit of scoreboard watching to see what South Windsor does these next couple days. Because as much as a lot of coaches don't like conference tournaments, I do think it would help for Conard to get in the conference tournament. They've deserved it the last 2 years, the way they played in the CCC North, been very competitive. They play Simsbury, and who knows, maybe they can get a surprise and they can play in the CCC North Championship. But they're going to be paying attention to that. Again, South Windsor needs 1 point, and they leapfrog Conard.
That's all it would take, as off the faceoff, Conard clears it all the way down. Winding it around the boards is Carr. This is Fortin, Jeremy Fortin, as he stick handles out of the zone. We have a whistle and a stoppage on the play. And it's the official talking to players from both sides. And now one of them comes over and talks to head coach Brian Cannon. Faceoff will come up in the neutral zone. Halfway through this third period, 7.5 to play. If you joined us late, we had a 1-1 tie about midway through the second period. And then Zach Polo took over, scored a natural hat trick, the last two goals 14 seconds apart in the last 40 seconds of the second period. And has his team comfortably in front by three, but they've been killing penalties, Matt, this whole third period.
And you got to believe at the end of the game, when the coaching staffs are talked to, especially the Conard coaching staff, they're going to go back to taking penalties. You do not want to take penalties. When you turn to March in high school hockey, the practices change a little bit, Peter. It's not the same drills you ran before. It's a lot more special team, this emphasis. Playoff games can be won. Tournament games can be won just by a turn of a dime in a power play situation. So right now, Conard's looking at this. Yes, we've got the win. We've beaten our rival. But how do we play cleaner moving forward? That's going to be the thing, to avoid those penalties against the better teams in Division II.
Well said. And certainly, it's going to be a point of emphasis going forward. Puck was cleared up into the Hall Southington bench, and a faceoff will come up in the neutral zone from the origin of that pass. Talked about the rebroadcast for this game. A week from tonight at 7 o'clock, 2 weeks from tonight at 7 o'clock, March 5th and 12th on WHC-TV, Channel 5. This is the last game of our winter sports schedule, and when we turn the calendar over and go towards April, our next broadcast will be a softball matchup, and then a doubleheader lacrosse action in May, and then we'll culminate everything with the Mayor's Cup baseball game at the University of Hartford on May the 23rd. So a lot of action coming up on your home for West Hartford High School Sports, WHC-TV Channel 5. Yeoman work on the penalty killing by the Chieftains as they send it down the ice once again. Jeremy Fortin, junior right winger, 10 goals on the season. Gets it up through center. At the line, Kalen Booth had it caught up in his skates before he finally puts it back into Conard territory. They wind it around the boards, held in at the right point by Kevin Carr, but then it eludes him out to center. Big hit on the play as Grayson Lacroix took a run at Fortin. Here's Carr at center ice, has to wait for a teammate to get back onside, and then Kilgore shoots it back in the Chieftain territory. Long headmanning pass through center, looking for the cherry picking forward, but it's going to go the length, and it's an icing call before Jackson Starr could chase it down for the Chieftain.
You know, we talked about wanting to improve on taking less penalties in the tournament. But the one thing that has stood out is when we've seen this penalty kill unit out there, they've been pretty darn good. One note that I did make a few minutes ago, and I do want to make sure I mention, is I thought Jack Alisi has been very good at holding the puck outside of the zone on the penalty kill, and that's something you're going to need because you are going to fall a man down from time to time in the tournament. Conard's got a pretty good penalty kill when they get put in that situation. Jack Alesi, one of the guys that stood out when they're in the on the PK.
Big kid. He's tough to move off that puck. And then you got the skill of somebody like Fonjamy, who's out there as an upfront penalty killer, and he's done an excellent job as well. So those two have been the main forwards used by head coach Greg Raymer and the Conard Chieftains. Here is Fonjamy. Just dumps it into Hall territory. Back behind the net. Liam Lacroix. Here's McCormick. Spins, has a man in front. Save is made. Rebound is loose. What a save off the mask by Frieda that time. Good reaction by the sophomore netminder for the Warriors. Turner from the right point of shot. It's sticked aside by Frieda. Fonjamy on the rebound. All the way to Turner. His shot blocked at the defense. That one stung Gambardella. Back behind the net. Kilgore trying to clear. And it goes out to center ice. And here's Florian. Good news for Hall Southington. He's in over the line. He veers in on goal. He shoots. Does he score? No, he does not. It's held by the goaltender. Good stop right there. But I believe another penalty against Conard.
Yeah, a couple great plays we got to highlight there. McCormick with a sensational pass. Low slot, finding his man. That's where they tell you to always look for your incoming forward. He found him perfectly with a great pass. And then Hall Southington breathes a big, big sigh of relief. They see their man, number 20, come out. And what does he do right when he gets back in the game? He creates a scoring opportunity. And Henderson with a great stop on Florian to keep the score the same.
So this is at least four power plays in this third period, I believe, for Hall Southington. Yeah, it was Jared Florian limping right below our vantage point just 5 minutes ago. Not only is he back on the ice, but he's using his tremendous speed. 4:20 to go in regulation. Hall Southington on the power play for the fifth time this afternoon. Shot blocked at the point, comes out to center. Conard almost had a break, but it's negated. Here's Arenow. In over the line, loses control. Back on the defense is Corcoran. He slides at the center. Opportunity here for Lacroix. He's in, he shoots, glove save, and a beauty by Frieda as he robbed Grayson Lacroix, the senior right winger, who was bidding for his ninth goal of the season.
Frieda let the game get a little away from him, and not his fault, but the game got away from him in that second period, but he still made a couple of great saves, and in the last 2 minutes, really showed why we were hyping him up, why we were so impressed with him. Right there, great save to keep this game as where it is. And then a few minutes before it, on the shot from the low slot, he was ready, did not get distracted, did not get out of position on the shot.
Yeah, he's bounced back nicely in this third period. There's no doubt about it. It's only probably one of the four goals that he would say and admit that he'd like to have back. That was a bad angle power play shot by Polo, his second goal that made it 3-1, and then he came back and scored again 14 seconds later, and for all intents and purposes, Conard was in cruise control.
Yeah, that was the backbreaker. When you give up two goals that quickly, it's hard to ignore the impact of that. You really get deflated, and that's a distance. You know, two-goal lead, you can come back for. A lot of coaches will say that's the worst lead in hockey. Three-goal lead is not the worst lead in hockey. They'll take that. Most coaches would sign up for that one beat. They're not going to give you coaches speak on that one. And I just before I turn the mic back to you, the one thing is we started this whole game by saying Hall Southington's coach called them consistently inconsistent. And you watch this game today, in a lot of ways, they've lived up to their head coach's billing. And they know that, and they'll be able to go back to the drawing board and work on this headed into the D3 tournament.
Big drive, and that goes wide. And the rebound reverberates all the way to center ice. Yeah, good points, Matt. And again, this is a team that can make some noise in the D3 tournament, and Conard as well in the D2 tournament. They're going to be very, very competitive. We talked about at the outset, Conard only one loss this year, and there are eight matchups in Division II. That came earlier this week.
Yeah, you know, you don't want to be too harsh, because I think Hall Southington has done a lot to be proud of in this game, too. I mean, they're a D3 team. that for they're still trying to figure out their identity. I know that's funny to say in February, but it's true. They don't quite know what type their team they are because of those inconsistent results. Today they put up two periods of pretty good hockey, even though falling behind 4-1. They played pretty strong hockey for the majority of that second period. So they got to go back, think, hey, we got to play clean hockey, we got to play together, and we got to play up tempo, and we got to back check. That's the key for them. And then for Conard, they want to play discipline and that use their speed to their advantage.
There's the speed again in front, and it's just out of the reach of the hard-charging Pat Corcoran. Now Hall on the attack. Pass goes behind Fortin in center ice. Jeremy gets it, slides it back to the Conard defense. Here's Lacroix, he's in, he scores! There it is, Grayson Lacroix. His second goal of the game, and that makes it 5-1 for the Chieftains late here in the third period, showing his tremendous speed with just 100 ticks to go, 140 on the clock, 5-1 Conard.
Pete, we talked about his ability to create plays, and you know what I've noticed watching Grayson today, and I have seen it before, but he's definitely shown it in this game, in this capacity. He can make that one quick move before the defenseman can react. He's got such a quick acceleration when the puck on his blade. And in that situation, he knew what he was going to do, made a beeline, sent it himself right to the goal, and put a good shot on. Tremendous player that knows how to create space and knows how to find the net. He's always positioning himself for the goal in the next big moment.
That was a terrific play. And his second goal of the afternoon. So three for Polo, two for Grayson Lacroix. Two different goal scorers, putting five on the board this afternoon for the Chieftains, as they will finish the regular season at the 500 mark, and certainly won't hurt their positioning as ranked and seeded right now, sixth in Division II.
Yeah, Conard's got a real good shot to win this thing at the end of the year. They're going to be seen as one of the favorites. They've played well with Fairfield Ludlow, Fairfield Ward. They have what you like to see in Division II contender. You quite possibly, they could run into another one of their CCC North foes in South Windsor. Two different teams. South Windsor, a team really led from the goaltender out. Offense, they want to keep it always a 2-3 goal game. Conard doesn't mind scoring. They'll play back and forth with you. At the same time, they can play defense. Maybe not the defensive team they were last year from a year ago, but this is not a pushover team defensively. Henderson today, although not as tested as much quite as Frieda, he has made a couple big saves. You look at the save totals for Henderson at this point, he's got 19 saves. So that's not a bad game by any stretch. All Southington would like a couple more shots on him, but the freshman goalie has really grown up this year and become a goalie that his team can rely on. And I think they're confident going into the postseason with him.
Sure. As well they should be, as he's been a freshman, but he hasn't played like one for a long time, that's for sure. Just want to tip our hats again to the seniors on both squads. Jordan Fonchamy, Patrick Kenna, Grayson Lacroix, Matt McCormick, Pat Corcoran, Brian Wilson, Jack Alissi of Conard, Kyler Cubbage, Paul Gambardella, Kalen Booth, Kevin Carr, Jack Rivers, Jared Florian, and Connor Domball of the Hall Warriors. All seniors, all playing in their final Hall-Southington-Conard matchup this afternoon. And for some of them, they've been four-year performers and have been consistent throughout. Especially when you look at somebody like Florian.
Yeah, and I really do want to highlight the Conard seniors, because they've done a really tremendous job of getting this program back to where a lot of people in town wanted to be with the coaching staff. I know this coaching staff has a lot of respect for what these seniors have done. They've really matured into great leaders and risen this program to new levels in the last 4 years.
And as you talked about, Matt, certainly a team to be reckoned with when the tournament begins in early March. Inside of a half minute to go. Centering pass, shot right on. And there's a big stop by Shea Henderson, stopping Jared Florian one more time. He was in the garden spot that time, about 5 feet in front, shaking hands with the freshman goaltender, who stood tall and made the save and held for the faceoff to his left. Conard defeating Hall for the ninth time in their last 10 matchups. The last Hall victory was 2 years ago, a 3-1 victory. Conard had won 7 matchups head-to-head before that. They won last year 5-2. And they're putting the finishing touches on what will be a 5-1 victory, barring any further scoring here this afternoon. And here are the Conard kids serenading. In the final 5 seconds of this one, it's put back into Conard territory. And that'll do it. The buzzer sounds, and the Conard Chieftains off the bench to mob their freshman goaltender, Shea Henderson. Big star this afternoon, as well as Zach Polo. 3 goals for him, 2 for Grayson Lacroix, and Matt Conyers, it adds up to a 5-1 Conard win.
Yeah, a really good job by Conard withstanding that early push from Hall Suddington. Hall Suddington came to play, make no mistake. They weren't going to get pushed around. They weren't going to play the part of the easy Division III opponent. But Conard had to raise their game, and they did. That second period, the last 5 minutes ago, so you saw the type of team Conard can be. They can really take a game over. That's why they're getting a lot of attention, a lot of spotlight from just not the media up north. The media down south likes this Conard team to make a run, and today they showed why. But overall, Peter, although the score might not be indicative of it, a great high school hockey game today. You look at the stands, a lot of students came out today, a packed student section for Conard, as we always expect when Conard comes to play. And then the other side, Hall Suddington, really came out to support their co-op. They was loud in here. We got a fun first period, some big shots, some big saves. What you look for in a high school rivalry game. In the end, it's the deeper team that wins away. But nothing that Hall Suddington has to hang their head too bad about. They're going to come back. They're going to regroup. They're going to go to work. And this is a team that still can get to Yale. Both teams can be going to Yale. And for West Hartford, that's a nice thing to say, that both their hockey teams and for Suddington as well could be playing late in the March. You like to hear that.
Absolutely. And be sure, as you go into March and you're following the tournament, be sure to look for Matt Conyers' excellent coverage in the Hartford Current, as he'll be all over all of the action, not just the West Hartford teams, but everybody throughout the state of Connecticut in Divisions 1, 2, and 3, and even the girls' action as well. And again, good luck to the Hall Conard Co-op girls' team as they play at New Canaan at 6 o'clock on Monday, SEC semifinal action. Matt, certainly enjoyed it. Thanks so much for being with us here today, and outstanding job.
Pete, always fun. Love coming out here. Love being part of this rivalry. It was a fun day and another a good year for high school hockey. Hopefully it continues in the tournament.
Okay, that was Matt Conyers. An excellent job with the analysis here this afternoon. Want you to stay tuned. We're going to have head coach Greg Raymer and one of the players as well. Perhaps either Zach Polo or Grayson Lacroix. That's going to come up in about 10 minutes or so. So if you're watching live on the broadcast, stay with us for that. Again, the final score here this afternoon, it was Conard 5, Hall Suddington 1. Stay tuned for the post-game interview as you continue to watch West Hartford High School Sports presented by the War Chief Sports Council here on WHC-TV Channel 5. Back after this.
who we play the Saints with. Yeah.
I don't know if it's hooked up. Congratulations, Coach. Good job, Captain.
Next Saturday and the Saturday after, I'll see yourself on TV.
Hey, do I need a headset out or no one? All right.
The old thumbs up.
Coach, we'll send you an email so you can send it out to your team that we're going to rebroadcast this March 5th and March 12th at 7 p.m.
We'll be busy on March 12th.
Oh, good.
We got a game. The 5th, we can make one.
Yeah. Somebody can tape it to them.
Can you DVR off that, Jim?
I don't know. I think so.
I don't know if I want to watch this game. Maybe just the interview.
Maybe not. Good? Whenever they're ready? All right. All right, Pete.
Five one, the final score this afternoon as the rivalry contest goes to Conard. And Greg Raymer, your thoughts on the victory here this afternoon that gets your team to the 500 mark to end the regular season?
Yeah, I mean, we're happy to get there. Hall played hard. It's one of those tough games, the rivalry games. It always gets a little chippy, and anytime you can come out on the top, it's good.
1-1 in the second period, and then Zach takes over. Natural hat trick. Last two goals, 14 seconds apart in the final 40 seconds of the second, and that really put it away.
Yeah, I mean, we look at it, Zach and on the line with Matt and Fonge, and that's the beauty of having those three guys together. They're explosive. Their ability to take games over in a heartbeat. Literally, they looked at me after they got the first one there, and they looked at me, and Matt looks at me and goes, "We're going to stay, coach." I said, "Okay, we'll let you go."
What has having those three kids together meant to you?
It's immeasurable. They kill penalties. They're on the power play. They're out there in critical moments. They've been fantastic. They do everything we ask. They play solid defensively. If we need a defensive stop, they're out there. And if we need offense, they're definitely out there.
Last year, got to the Division II semifinals. Okay. No, we won't ask you for a prediction, but a dull overtime loss to North Brantford. You avenged that loss with a 2-0 victory in nice fashion last Saturday. As you look ahead, the one thing, your team does have to be considered one of the favorites. You told me, hey, we only had one loss in Division II all season long, so certainly moving ahead, you're going to be one of those guys that's going to be in there.
We're in the top of D2. We can compete, and we bring our A game. We're as good as anybody.
Well, thanks so much. Thanks for prepping with us, getting ready for the game. And congratulations and best of luck in March.
Hey, thanks a lot. We appreciate you guys coming out.
Greg Raymer, the head coach. Matt McCormick, you wear the C for a reason. Your coach calls you the consummate team captain, great leader. Congratulations on a great season and the victory today. A couple more assists, 26 assists on the season, 1.3 per contest. Pretty darn good.
Yeah, I got to thank my line mates, Fonge and Polo. They get me the puck, and then I give it right back. We always try to get that tic-tac-toe goal.
on the power play, bad angle drive by Polo, gets the goal, puts them up 3-1 at that point, comes right back 14 seconds later. How explosive and how good is he?
He's one of the best players I've ever played with. You know, you just get him the puck and let him go to work. He's got a great shot, great speed. He's got it all.
Optimistic coming into March?
Oh, yeah. Well, we're definitely going to be there right at the top at the end of March. We're going to be up there with the best teams in the state.
And to be one of the best teams in the state, you have to have that number one line going with the goals today. 53 goals for your top line this year.
We just been clicking. We've really been clicking of late over these D2 teams, North Brantford. Even though we lost to Fairfield, that was actually one of our off games. Suffield, we came right back, put up 8 goals on them. We're just really clicking right now.
Well, congratulations again. Best of luck in March.
Thank you.
Okay, Matt McCormick joining us along with Greg Raymer. Conard with the victory today, 5-1 over Hall Southington. They end the regular season at 9-9-2, and a lot coming up as they go into March. Thanks as always to everybody involved with the broadcast, Paul McConnell, Dennis Swanton with the War Chief Sports Council, all the ladies involved from Channel 5, and as always, our volunteer photographers couldn't do it without them. Thanks for watching at home, and until our spring schedule, which begins on April 29th with softball action, so long, everybody.